Welcome back to Kingdom Builder. I am joined by a very special guest, and I say very special because I've known this guy for about 16 years now. I remember first meeting him in 2007 when he released his major label debut record, The Blessing. I'm joined today by the one and only John Waller. John, how are you doing today, man?
I'm good, Jay. How about yourself?
I'm doing pretty good, man. Can you believe that we've known each other and been talking and all that for 16 years now? Does it seem like it's been that long?
Nope, not at all. Not at all.
No, you know what? It is crazy. And, you know, when I think back to that, I remember getting a pre-release of The Blessing from, I believe it was Beach Street Records, was the label that you were on with Provident Label Group. And I remember looking at the picture on the cover with this dude on there with glasses, and kind of the first thing I thought was, this guy looks like Buddy Holly.
That's great. Yeah, and I probably looked more like Buddy Holly than I looked like myself in that picture, looking back on it.
Yeah, and that was a great record. You know, that was my first introduction to your music. And of course, you know, I went back to your earlier days and According to John, and, you know, we just became friends from there. I remember doing the first interview with you shortly after that record came out, and then met in person for the first time, I believe, at Rock the Universe 2007 in Orlando, Florida. And both of us were much younger then, and we had probably less than half of the kids that we have today. I believe that you had four.
I had three at the time. Yeah, Sophie, who, you know, I just did the duet with, which we'll talk about, but she was 2 years old and she's 18 now. So that's crazy.
Yeah, I had two at the time. Mariah was eight, and Hannah was a year old. Hannah's fixing to be 17. So, and I have five now. You have 10. You have nine. I don't want to add a kid to your. Oh, you do have 10. Okay, Journey. You have Journey. Yep. So you do have 10. So you have twice as many kids, and obviously, neither one of us thought 16 years ago that we would probably have the boatload of kids that we have now, because I sure as heck didn't.
No.
So, John, going back to, you know, the beginning, you were born and raised in Georgia. When did you realize that you had musical ability? And did you ever think back then that one day you would do music as a career?
Wow. I don't think so. I don't think it was till really high school, probably my senior year, that the desire just kind of hit me pretty hard. And it was really because I had been so impacted by Stephen Curtis Chapman, and his music came into my life in a, you know, a moment of where I really stepped into my walk of faith for the first time. And that music just kind of came alongside me and was there for me daily. And I mean, I devoured his music. You know, it was like I'd heard a lot of Christian music and artists before that. Petra, I was a big Petra fan as a kid. And, you know, even like, you know, I heard a lot of Michael W. Smith, DeGarmo and Key, all these, you know, pillar Christian artists from those days. But then Stephen Curtis came along. You know, and he was playing an acoustic guitar, which everybody else was playing keyboard before that, you know, the real 80s keyboard sound. And then here's this guy with an acoustic guitar and this amazing voice. And so that's what really, that was the beginning of me deciding I wanted to do this.
And, you know, you mentioned Stephen Curtis Chapman, and he, of course, is, you know, a legend in Christian music. I mean, he's got, I believe a couple of years ago, he hit the 50 number one mark. I mean, that's unprecedented in Christian music. I think the closest behind him maybe is Michael W. Smith or Amy Grant, but more than, you know, 50 number one hits on radio. I mean, that's absolutely crazy. You know, I was listening to a playlist the other day, and you know, a song came on, just a random song, and it was Stephen Curtis Chapman's "I Will Be Here." And you know, having lost my wife Shannon almost 2 years ago, got really emotional because I remember her telling me that that was her favorite song that he had done, and that was a song that really encouraged her and got her through a lot. So Stephen Curtis Chapman plays a huge role as far as influences Christian music wise in my life as well. And I'm actually hoping to see him next month. He's going to be in Florida. It's been a while since I've seen him in concert. So hopefully I'll be able to see him. And, you know, speaking of, you mentioned acoustic guitar. I remember one of the first tracks I heard from him back in 2004, when I started getting into Christian music, was the song "Lord of the Dance." And it's, you know, it starts with that really cool acoustic intro. And I'm like, wow, I like this. And that song really got me hooked on him. And then I just went and listened to all of his other stuff and, you know, discovered just how much of a treasure he is in CCM.
Oh, absolutely. "I'll Be Here." I can't tell you how many times I sang that in weddings. And I remember I remember having a video of him. I think it was called Frontline. It was like a video series of all these different artists, and it was an acoustic, you know, just kind of stripped down. It was almost like the MTV Unplugged, but it was the Christian version. And I remember I bought that VHS of him, and I just watched him, you know, watched his fingers and learned how to play his songs the way he plays them. And that's the song that I was singing all the time and singing countless weddings. And yeah, 50 number ones at radio. I'm right there behind him. I got 0 number ones at radio, but I'm catching up with him.
Radio is a different kind of beast, man. It's either you're in it or you're not. And unfortunately, I've had conversations about the radio thing over the years. And
yeah,
you know, I know that it's been discouraging to you, but, you know, just going back to the last 16 years of the music that you've put out, I can tell you, me personally, I've been deeply affected, encouraged, and uplifted by the music that you have, you know, released over the years. And I've, you know, you and I have had conversations about that over time of different songs that have gotten to me. And, you know, being in the Christian music industry, on the other side of the spectrum, as like a member of the media, I get pre-releases all the time. And I remember back when, you know, I told you this story a while back when The Blessing came out, you know, at that point in time, I had gotten tons of records, listened to stuff. And normally, very rarely did I ever become personally affected by songs. I mean, there were songs that were great songs. People were like, oh, this is the best song ever. you know, just an amazing song. But I remember the one song from The Blessing that was, you know, and is still one of my favorites from that record, is "Still Calls Me Son." And I remember telling you that, you know, I remember hearing you tell the story about that song. And, you know, I was explaining to my late wife, Shannon, you know, what that song had meant. And I'm listening to it on the car radio. And all of a sudden I start getting emotional and start getting tears in my eyes. And she's like, what's wrong with you? And it's at that point that I realized that song reminded me that person that you're writing about in that song, which of course is, you know, the story of the prodigal son in the Bible, was me at the time. And it took me explaining the meaning of that song for me to like open my eyes and realize that I was starting to stray and that I needed to turn back. And, you know, very rarely does a song ever do that to me. And I remember that was one of the first songs that really tripped me up and got me realizing that, you know, hey, you need to turn around and go the other direction, because you're starting to stray off in a direction that, you know, God didn't intend for you to go.
Yeah, that's awesome. I remember you sharing that story with me for the first time. I remember where I was standing. We were living in a temporary house. It was a missionary home for our church, because we had just moved back from Colorado and we didn't know where we were going to live. And I remember doing that interview with you for the first time. And I remember you sharing that story with me.
Yeah. So let's go to the records. You know, you started out with the indie rock band According to John, and you know, you had a lot of local success up there in Georgia. Tell us about that time in your life when you were doing that band and, you know, what your hopes and aspirations were, you know, when you were touring with the group.
Oh, man. You know, the funny thing is, I had done four records before, according to John Ever, got together. And one of the reasons I started, I'd won a songwriting competition that Babby Mason was a word artist back in the day and out of Atlanta. And she had the songwriting seminar and I went to it and I entered to, you know, to win a trip to Estes Park, Colorado for the big Christian artist seminar in the Rockies. And I ended up winning with a song called Standing Ovation, which is one I'd written and recorded as a solo artist. And I went out there to Colorado and I met a bunch of industry people and I thought, this is going to be it for me. This is where I'm going to, you know, get a record deal and blah, blah, blah. And I met a guy out there named John Mays, and John Mays, he's the guy that started, Centricity Records and just incredible legend. I mean, he is to A&R what Stephen Curtis Chapman is as an artist, you know, he's the legend A&R guy. I mean, he's been behind so many artists, but I remember walking up to him and talking to him because he was actually Babby Mason's A&R guy. And I remember him telling me the next big thing is bands. And so that's one of the reasons that I started a band and we ended up calling it According to John. You know, we were together for 7 years and we made a lot of music and toured a whole lot. My aspirations were to, you know, be, you know, one of the top bands, like a Third Day or Jars of Clay at the time. And it seemed like we were on our way towards that, but, you know, it ended up, you know, falling apart, not working out, but that was really one of the best things that ever happened to me, is for God to not allow that to happen.
Yeah. You know, going back to that, I remember, and I don't remember if you sent this to me or if I got this from somewhere else, but I had got a copy of, I guess, like an According to John compilation record called Greater Things. And it basically had all of the songs, like the handpicked songs from you guys that you had done over that 7 year period of time. And I remember there were two songs that really stuck out to me that I really liked a lot. The first one, of course, was I Choose You. And that was a song that I remember actually hearing prior to hearing the According to John version. I heard the Point of Grace version back actually in 2004. I think that's when they recorded their version of it. And So I remember hearing your version and I'm like, wow, they did a cover of the Point of Grace song. And then it dawned on me, I'm like, wait a second, Point of Grace didn't write that song. John Waller, Jason Horde, and the guys from According to John wrote that. And that was an amazing song, a proclamation song. Yeah, and the other song that I really liked from According to John was Everlasting. And that was a song that I really like, you know, focused on, you know, John 3:16. And, you know, it's kind of a sad song, but it's a great song. And that's also one of my favorites. And then, so after According to John, you're in between, you are still in Georgia, and you get a calling to take a position as a worship pastor or worship leader out in Colorado. Tell us about that experience.
Yeah. You know, According to John ending was hard. It was the end of a dream. It was just really devastating for me. And so at that point I was really open to anything. And I had always been a part-time worship guy. You know, I had a friend that brought me in, you know, and if I wasn't on the road, I was at his church leading worship. And so they had moved to Colorado to plant a church and he found out that According to John had broken up. So he called me and I remember I was standing in a Target and he called me and asked me if I would consider, you know, just coming out there and visiting and seeing how it felt and if I would be interested in being the worship pastor for a church plant. And I was open to anything because I didn't know what else to do. So we ended up moving out there and it was great. I mean, it was a new season. It was a season to heal from a lot of hard, you know, hard things that I had endured being in the band and my dream being crushed. And so I think we had been out there about a year when I felt the Lord tell me that, because I had, for the first year, I was still kind of mourning the loss of my dream to be an artist. And so the Lord said, you know, your mourning is over. It's time to write. I'm about to pour out my spirit. I'm going to give you songs. And then I started writing and it just started flowing. And I wrote so many songs. It was crazy. And we would do them at church on Sunday. And because I didn't just want to do worship covers. I'm a writer. I'm an artist. I don't mind doing covers, but I wanted something that came from my heart because I knew that I could do it. And we started doing these songs and it was amazing. And then the church was like, you got to record these songs. And I'm like, well, it takes a lot of money to record these songs and to do it right. And they raised the money. And I did this album. It was called Say to My Soul. And that album ended up, you know, leading, you know, opening the door for my true dream. There's a lot more to it than that, as you know, but that really led, you know, led to the what God had for me.
My Soul was a great record. I remember somebody, you put me in contact with somebody at the church because you didn't actually have copies of Say It to My Soul. And I remember emailing somebody from the church and they sent me a box of them. I mean, there was like probably, you know, 8 to 10 copies of that record. And I remember several years ago, I gave you a couple copies of it because I don't even think you had any more copies of it. But,
no.
You know, after hearing the blessing and going back, you know, to Say to My Soul, I remember there was quite a few songs on that record that would end up on your major label debut. And my two favorite songs from Say to My Soul, and I want to play one of these here in a moment, but the two songs that I really liked the most on that record, I mean, of course, the whole record was amazing, but two songs really stuck out was Reckless and Crown. And those two were only on that record. Those didn't get re-recorded for the blessing. But do you remember anything about either one of those songs and, you know, what inspired you to write those?
Wow. You know, that's funny you say that those two are your favorite. Yeah, it's hard to remember. I've written a lot of songs over the years. And, you know, at the time, it was just really just about reckless abandonment and worship. And I was always playing electric guitar when I led worship at church. And I wrote that with Jason Horde, who produced that album. And, you know, of course, he brought his incredible guitar skills to that song. And it was just fun. It was just a fun song. It always went over well at church. I wouldn't say there was a lot of, you know, there wasn't necessarily a story behind it other than just, you know, we're here to worship in a reckless kind of way, I guess. And then you mentioned Crown. That was just based on the old hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns. My favorite songs off that record is Identity, which ended up being on The Blessing. And even, you know, one of the American Idol guys recorded it as well. Phil something. I can't remember his name. But
Phil Stacy
recorded it. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that was my favorite. And of course, Something Big, which also made it onto the Blessing record as well.
Yeah. Two other great songs. Well, let's go ahead and play one of the songs from Say to My Soul. We'll go with Reckless because that was... you know, was actually my favorite song from the record. So why don't you go ahead and introduce that song for us while we play it?
Hi, I'm John Waller, and this is my song from way back in the day, Reckless.
And with passion to bring our hearts into alignment.
That was John Waller with Reckless from his 2006 record, Say to My Soul. Now, John, jumping in 2007, this was a huge jump for you. You're in Colorado. You're a worship pastor out there. Your music gains the attention of a record label. And tell us about that experience. You were Mark Miller from Sawyer Brown. I guess heard the record. Tell us about getting signed and what that experience is like, kind of leading up to you getting signed with Beach Street.
It was one of the greatest experiences of my life. The way the Lord set that up was amazing. So when I was making Say to My Soul, Brian Scoggin, who went on to be Casting Crowns drummer for like over 10 years. But at the time he had only filled in for them. And he was with According to John. So I reached out to him and said, "Hey, you think you could ask Mark Hall if he would sing on one of the songs for this album I'm doing?" And Mark knew According to John, and he agreed, like, you know, with no hesitation, which I was just blown away by that. And so I remember Jason Horde went over to Mark's house with a laptop and recorded him on a song called The Blessing, which honestly, I didn't even pick The Blessing for him to sing on. I had picked a song, Something Big, for him to sing on. But for some reason, I sent the wrong song, or Jason took the wrong song over there. And then they're in the process of recording, and I found out that he was singing on The Blessing. And I was like, "Oh, okay, well, that song works too." And so I remember it was my birthday, and I was skiing in Colorado with my pastor, and Jason sent me an MP3 of Mark Hall singing on it, and it just blew my mind, you know, because Crowns was exploding at that time. And then I talked to Mark on the phone. I thanked him, and he said, "Hey, man, I'll send this to, you know, Mark Miller." And I was excited, and he sent The Blessing and Identity on a disc. At, you know, this is before you would text a MP3 right through your phone. He mailed him a disc, and I didn't hear anything for 6 months. I mean, it was, I just thought, you know, that I'm never going to hear anything back on this, and I was used to that, but it was still, once again, a blow to me, and I was really struggling with that, and I remember being really discouraged one day, and a friend called me up, and I told him what I was wrestling with, and he encouraged me to write a song about that, you know, and so I hung up the phone, and I reluctantly started writing how I was feeling, and that's, and about 7 minutes later, I had a song that I wrote without even thinking about it, and it was While I'm Waiting. It's probably the only song I've ever written like that quick, and like, done. Never tweaked it, never changed it. It was just was what it was. That Sunday, we learned it at rehearsal, and then we played it Sunday, and everybody was moved by it. My drummer said, that's your big song, I think. And I was like, "Wow, you think so?" And it was like that next week I get a call from Mark Miller. Out of the blue, I wasn't expecting it, and I was blown away. In fact, my wife and I were in the basement organizing old A to J merchandise that was, you know, I could do nothing with it. It was just all in the basement, all scattered everywhere. The kids were in it. So we were folding T-shirts, and I'm like, I can never do anything with these T-shirts. They're irrelevant, you know, but yet we're organizing it, and I resented that, and it brought out all these feelings, and then I get the call while I'm doing that. And then I talked to Mark, and then he asked me if I could come to Nashville, and I was blown away by that. And I was like, "Yeah, I can come to Nashville." And he's like, "Can you come tomorrow?" And I'm like, "Tomorrow?" I'm like, "I guess I can." And so I was on a plane the next day. And I remember we went to a little cafe called Loveless Cafe in Franklin. It's a very famous place. And that's where he offered me the record deal.
That's awesome. And I remember you telling me the story about that years ago. And that was just an amazing story, and just how that song culminated, like, you know, I'll worship you while I'm waiting. And, you know, that song is, you know, easily your most popular song. The song went on to be featured in the movie Fireproof with Kirk Cameron. And I might add, you know, with all of the Kendrick Brothers films, I don't remember any song in any of their movies being played in its entirety, on the exception of While I'm Waiting. I mean, and they've done a lot of movies, they've done a lot of films. And to my knowledge, that's the only song that they have played the entire song in the movie. And I think it's because that I think you were telling me that when Alex Kendrick heard that song and wanted to feature it, it played such a pivotal role and kind of matched what the movie was doing, that they ended up using the whole song, which, you know, going back to that, you know, your films in the movie, you had While I'm Waiting in the movie Fireproof. You had As For Me in My House on the soundtrack of
Courageous,
which I was on the set of that movie in Albany, Georgia in 2010. And then Crazy Faith, the song Crazy Faith was featured in War Room. So, yeah. You know, going back when you found out that While I'm Waiting was going to be featured in Fireproof, what was your initial reaction to that?
I was on a tour bus with Casting Crowns. And I remember we had sent Still Calls Me Son to radio.
That was the Altar in the Door tour, right?
Yes. And that was the song at Still Calls Me Son, the one you mentioned earlier that really moved you and you had to pull over on the side of the road. We thought that would be my career song, my first career song. And I remember it was not going well at radio. It's like, guys, they weren't adding it. And I was very discouraged. And I remember getting a voicemail from Alex Kendrick, and he just said, "Hey man, I love your song. It fits great in the movie. It's getting great response in all the screenings across the country." And that was all he said. And I was like, I had no idea what he was talking about. I didn't know what song they had chosen. And I didn't even know that I was up for it. You know, I didn't even know that my songs had been pitched for it. And so I called him back and he told me it was While I'm Waiting. And I was just blown away. I was so encouraged because, first of all, that was my favorite song on the whole record. It was at the end of the record. And no one had ever mentioned it at the label prior to that. It had never been considered as a, you know, anything, not a radio single. No one even said it was a good song. I don't even know if they had even heard it, you know, besides Mark Miller. But it really was just a huge deal. And without that, I probably wouldn't have really had a career.
Yeah. And you know, like you said before, that song was, you know, it's crazy how the Lord works sometimes. You said that song was something that you wrote very quickly and it just came to you. And mm-hmm. yet that is the most popular song that you've written. And it's also had the highest feature. I mean, being featured in a film, I mean, that's an ultimate culmination of what a song can do as far as placement goes. And, you know, And you know, speaking of The Blessing, before we move on to the next record, The Blessing, I remember a couple times, you know, I'm a singer and a guitarist myself, obviously not as talented as you are, but I remember a couple times you've come to Florida. I've actually got to go up on stage and sing The Blessing, sing Mark Hall's part on that song, which has always been a highlight of my amateur career, is being able to share the stage with you and sing that song. So I greatly appreciate you having me up there. But you know, that whole record was great. And you know, I remember talking to you when you were putting together the 2009 record While I'm Waiting, and you had sent me a demo version, and I actually sent you this file a couple of days ago because I didn't know if you'd still had it, but you'd sent me a demo version of the track Our God Reigns Here. And I remember that was the second time I interviewed you, I asked you about that song, and you had told me that you'd wrote that song on a mission trip to Wales. And you know, when I first heard that song, number one, it had this like eerie Western feel to it. Almost feel like it would, like the instrumental would fit into like a Clint Eastwood soundtrack. Yeah. And when I heard the words and just, you know, heard the final version that would be on the While I'm Waiting record, gave me chills. And still to this day, Our God Reigns Here is one of my favorite songs that you've done. And I think even though that song was recorded and featured back in 2009, even 14 years later, I think that song is even more pertinent now, because it just seems like our society is getting worse and worse. And just everything you speak on in that song, just proclaiming Jesus and God's reign over everything. You know, I demand you leave in Jesus' name. Take us back to that song. I saw an interview with you recently. You said that was actually one of your favorite songs as well that you've done over the years. What are your thoughts on that song now? And, you know, has that changed at all since you wrote that?
No, not really. It is one of those timeless songs, I think. I recently was at a conference leading worship, and I did that song, and just, you wouldn't believe how it changed the atmosphere, like, immediately. And a lot of these people had never heard it before, but it didn't matter. And when I wrote it, it was just in the midst of a lot of spiritual oppression in the place we were at on this mission trip. And I wrote it for the sake of declaring something with the group that were on the trip that would dispel the darkness in the atmosphere. And I remember the first time we did it, it was like, whoa, you know? So I just knew that it was powerful. It was from the Lord. And I wish it could have been just had more reach, you know, just more visibility, you know, but it ain't over yet.
Yeah, it's a great song. Why don't we go ahead and play that one? You want to introduce it for us?
Yeah. I'm John Waller, and this is one of my favorite songs I've ever written. It's called Our God Reigns Here.
Spirit of death, you have no place here. I command you to leave in Jesus' name. Spirit of fear, you have no place here. I command you to leave in Jesus' name. You're not welcome here. So go, so go, just go. You to leave in Jesus' name. Envy and jealousy, you have no place here. I command you to leave in Jesus' name. Jesus. claim this crown in Jesus' name, 'cause I can't rest.
That was Our God Reigns Here, and I have the singer on that song, John Waller, with me on the phone, or on Zoom. You know, technology changes over the year. We used to do interviews over the phone. Now we do them video.
Yeah.
You know, John, jumping ahead to 2011, this was another record that I was excited for, because I remember you sending me, you know, some early stuff from this record. But 2011, you released As For Me In My House, and of course, the title track from that movie, or from that record, ended up on the soundtrack of the 2011 Kendrick Brothers movie, Courageous. And I love the title track based on Joshua 24:15. Choose you this day and you'll serve. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And that was a huge song. I love that song. And, you know, that record as a whole was just a great record. The song Yes was another favorite of mine on that record. God says yes to his promises, take him at his word. And, you know, great song, great uplifting song. But I think the one song that I really liked most from that record, and this has kind of been my prayer over the years as a Christian, is there was always somebody that was a part of my story of salvation. Like my wife, Shannon, and my friend Greg, both were the two top influences on me finding Christ myself. Actually, June 25th marks 20 years of me being saved. So I don't know where I'd be today if it wasn't for my late wife Shannon and my best friend from high school, Greg. Greg in particular prayed for me, told me this, prayed for me every day from when we were freshmen in high school in 1995. Until I got saved in 2003. He said that he had prayed for me every day. And I didn't know this until after I called him one day. And I said, dude, I just got saved. And the phone just went silent. I thought the phone disconnected. And I'm like, are you still there? And he's like, yeah, man. And he sounded choked up. He's like, are you okay? He's like, dude, I have been praying for you every single day for the last 6 years. That the Lord would reveal himself to you and that you would find Jesus. And I didn't know that. So for him, you know, prayer works. And then of course, when I met my wife, she took me to church and I ended up getting saved. So, you know, that the song, Somebody Else's Story, is my favorite off of that record, because that's been my prayer in the 20 years I've been saved, is that I want to be a part of somebody else's story of finding salvation, finding God, finding Jesus, finding love. And, you know, going back to that song, you know, was there something that inspired you to write that? What was the story behind Somebody Else's Story?
Wow. You know, that's just something that, I mean, I'm the same way. I had so many people that were a part of my story, along the way, who, you know, sowed into me, poured into me, you know, even, you know, I got to tell Stephen Curtis Chapman, you know, later on in life, that he was that for me. He was part of my story. And, you know, so that's really what inspired it. It was just the gratitude at the time for all the people who had played a role, you know, in my journey.
All right, why don't we play that one right now? You want to introduce it for us?
Yes. Hi, I'm John Waller, and this is my song, Somebody Else's Story.
I want to be a part, I want to be a part of somebody finding love. Somebody finding love unfailing. I wanna be a part, I wanna be a part of somebody finding life. Somebody finding life everlasting. And I wanna play a part, I wanna play a part of somebody finding hope. Somebody finding hope in God of heaven. It's my desire, Lord, you would use me to change somebody else's destiny. I wanna be a part, I wanna be a part of somebody else's story. Somebody else's story. Someone, I pray, Lord, I want to bring you glory in somebody else's story. Somebody else's story. I want to be a part, I want to be a part. Somebody finding comfort. Somebody finding comfort when they're hurting. And I wanna play a part, I wanna play a part of caring for the widow, sheltering the orphan. It's my desire, Lord, you will use me somebody else's destiny. I wanna be a part, I wanna be a part of somebody else's story. Somebody else's story of redemption. I wanna be the one, I wanna be the one to shine the light of Jesus into their darkness. Story, somebody else's story of redemption. This hope in me was not meant to be contained inside. I've got to give it away, give it away. This hope in me was not meant to be contained inside. Somebody else's story. Somebody else's story of redemption.
All right, John. 2015, you released Crazy Faith. Of course, the title track was featured in the Kendrick Brothers film War Room. And You know, my favorite song on that, and let's talk real quickly about, you know, obviously there's a story behind this song, your wife Josie being adoptive parents, but the song Orphan, you know, you wrote that song, you know, inspired by your own adoption story. Why don't you tell us about that story?
Yeah, I mean, I keep mentioning Stephen Curtis, but, you know, he had, because of his adoption of his three girls from China, it really planted the seed in me to want to adopt one day. And so we had our fifth child, and Josie started feeling that desire as well. And so we went down that path. We prayed about it. And I had a dream about our youngest adopted daughter, Anna. And in the dream, I met her, and I knew her name. I knew how old she was. I knew what part of the world she was from. And it was just really supernatural. And we ended up finding her a few days later. And then she, of course, had a brother. And we took both of them in for the summer and then decided to adopt them. And then found out they had another sister right before we finished the process. But it was a huge, huge step of faith for us. And it was very crazy and literally crazy to everyone in our life. And that's what inspired me to write a song, you know, about crazy faith, because real faith does look crazy to everyone else.
Exactly. And, you know, you and I both, we both share that same story. I didn't adopt three, but my 14-year-old son, Zachary, we adopted him in 2010. So my wife and I had adopted as well. So that's why that song is a favorite of mine, because, you know, it you know, tells us the story from my point of view. And it was crazy. You know, we had three kids at the time, and, you know, her and I discussed about having another child, but we ultimately decided to adopt instead. So why don't we go ahead and play that song? You want to go ahead and introduce it for us?
Yeah. This is John Waller, and this is my song, Crazy Faith.
That mountain, tell it just to move. This is crazy, yeah. But her face in that picture, I said that's our daughter. But we can't swim this ocean, but you're telling us to move. This is crazy, yeah. Lord, this scares me, yeah, but it's gonna take crazy faith. So what if it cost everything? I'm stepping out, I'm taking the leap of crazy faith. Children, where we never thought we'd go. This is crazy, Lord. I never thought we'd go, and it scares me.
That was Crazy Faith from John Waller. John joins us on the Zoom right now. And John, over the next 4 years, you would release two more records, Good News and Explosions of Light. Good News, my favorite song from that is, of course, the Coffee song, My Awakening. And you for a short time did the Crazy Faith coffee thing, which is cool. I still have my mug, still have my Crazy Faith coffee mug, a little plane on it, which is really cool. And then, you know, just the words of that song, it's funny, but it's so true. You know, I need a whole lot of Jesus and a little bit of caffeine. And that was, you know, caffeine, of course, is my personal awakening in the morning. So John, that leads us to your brand new single that comes out today. It's called Yeshua. And that song is not only a great song, but you have a special guest singer on that song. Who is this talented female singer that you have on the song with you?
Well, that's my daughter, man. She's 18. Her name is Sophie. And when you and I met, she was only two, but she's grown up, and I'm really excited about it. She has the most amazing voice. It's the second song I've recorded with her. The first one was called What My Father Does. And I've recorded one with my 21-year-old daughter, and one I've also recorded an unreleased song with my son Bailey. And they're actually in the process of recording music together now, the three of them, which is exciting. But Yeshua, the name is a song that's we're excited to put out. Don't know what's gonna happen with it, but it's a great song, and I just love, you know, Jesus's real name is Yeshua. That's what his mother called him, and so that's what I'm gonna call him.
Awesome. Well, why don't we go ahead and play that? I'm excited to play this. You want to go ahead and introduce this new song for you?
Yes. I'm John Waller, and I'm proud to introduce you my brand new single with my daughter Sophie Waller. It's called Yeshua, the name.
Over the morning and over the evening, over the mountain and over the valley, over the demons and armies of say the name, Yeshua. Yeah.
That was a brand new single from John Waller. It's called Yeshua, the name. And we're totally excited to be able to play that. John, you sent me that song several weeks back. And of course, I enjoy always getting new music from you. So, you know, John, in closing, legacy, it's a Legacy Sessions interview. You know, I would think that you would say about yourself that, you know, you're already seeing your legacy in action. You have 3 children that are following your steps in music. And it's not just that they're following your steps. It's these 3 kids are talented. Your oldest son, Bailey, your oldest daughter, Hadley, and your next youngest daughter, Sophie, have all been involved in your music ministry. And like you mentioned, they're going to be doing their own thing together, which is awesome. But, mm-hmm. you know, when we're all long gone, and, you know, people hear the name John Waller, you know, what do you want your legacy to be? What do you want people to remember John Waller for the most?
That he put his family, he put God and his family over everything else, you know, and he, because nobody's going to care about my career and my, what I accomplished with music. It's really going to come down to my marriage and my children. And they are my legacy. They're my greatest reward and they're my greatest accomplishment. And so I don't need all the other accolades because they're very fleeting, especially now, you know, it's like something's cool today. Tomorrow it's like, I don't even remember it. You know, that's how fast everything's moving. So my legacy is my family for sure.
Well, that's the greatest legacy that we can leave behind is, you know, what we leave for our kids. And I'm hoping the same thing. I'm hoping that I can leave a legacy for my kids. And I'm in even a bigger role now as a single parent and a widow. I have to, you know, really step up my game because it's just me here now. So my kids are looking up to basically me. So, you know, John, I really appreciate you joining us today. It's been a pleasure talking to you as always. And, you know, I'm just praying that the Lord continues to do big things through your music and through this new single, Yeshua. Great song. You can go over to iTunes and where digital music is sold today and check it out. And the music video is also up today. So go check that out. John, thank you so much for joining us. And until next time, peace and blessings, my friend.
Yeah, thank you, Jay. Back at you, man.